Take your picture.
October 10th, 1989, en route to Glen Eyrie in Colorado Springs, Colorado, Raton Pass.
That's all, folks.
It's 5 o'clock this morning. Stars are fading quietly. Night is nearly gone. So you turn away from me, and tears begin to come. And it's goodbye again. I'm sorry to be leaving you. Goodbye again. If you didn't know.
You want to see me close?
Here we go upstairs.
Okay. Take us on a tour, yeah. Betty.
Well, here's somebody's bedroom over here. Here's a nice bathroom. We've never had this bathroom before.
Right. This is where General Palmer let his servant stay. We felt like it does have its own private bathroom, but we felt like this year we would stay in a hotel instead of staying in the servant's wing of the castle. But we thought we would give every one of you of where we have stayed in the past. Follow me. Here's the lovely bathroom. Enough for this room. Let's go look at other rooms in the castle. Okay, and at the end of the trip, on Saturday morning before we leave, we have to strip the beds and take all the linen and separate bed sheets, pillowcases, towels that we've used the whole 4 days without a change for fresh towels, and we'll put them in the hall.
Hi, Betty.
Hi, Patty.
The steps are so tiring with stuff.
ET phone home.
Now, this is a cute room.
Hmm? Sunlight.
It's, hi guys.
Hello. I'm Peggy.
Y'all come for a visit anytime.
We've had that twice. Huh. So we never did get a good room, so this year we'll stay in a hotel.
Which hotel
are
you staying
at? This is a view from the Nichols rooms. They have their own balcony overlooking the grandeur of Glen Eyrie. That's where we play bocce ball, down on the grounds. Beautiful, beautiful grounds.
Given him too much medication again? Oh. Good. To have a husband that will do anything for you. Carry all your bags. Always. Always. I mean, you know, it's really great. I don't mind unloading all of these bags.
And
what she
had,
did.
And who had to pack it all?
Had I packed it all?
Can I rest?
Well, what she did. What she did. And see if he can lift this bag.
Great.
See if he can lift it. See? He can't even lift it. Edie, but look at that.
Unbelievable.
That's the eagle. We keep trying to figure out how we can unload it to our vehicle all the way home every day.
Just sitting here amongst the bird poop, my black bag flashing against my heart.
Outside of the castle. Here are some of the grounds of the Glen Eyrie complex. This is all part of the Garden of the Gods, which General Palmer, who founded Colorado Springs, donated Garden of the Gods to the city of Colorado Springs, and this was his retreat, 2,000 acre retreat that is still left intact. It's beautiful. We have the back view of the castle looking down from the southwest side. The castle just sits nestled in a little valley. You cannot see it from Colorado Springs, and you cannot really hear the traffic of the freeways. General Palmer had Scottish masonries come in to build the castle back in the 1870s. Beautiful trees landscape the lawn. I believe they told us that they had over 2,000 varieties of trees and plants that most weren't indigenous to the Colorado area. Glen Eyrie.
I don't want to be in there.
You don't want to be in there? Okay.
We've got like salad here.
Yeah, okay.
We've got like salt and stuff. Now the pasta like white stuff.
Lisa.
Oh, I just kept sitting here talking to you.
Yeah, let me.
Hello.
Feet in your face. Sad.
Nobody wants to sit. Nobody wants to sit.
Cruelty to the animals.
Kind of what I call a tiger print appearance if you look at some of the panel here. Also, if you look at the panel
Also, down here in the corner, 29 and a half feet to the center beam up there in the middle. Basically 30 if you round it all off. Do you believe me?
No, but I'm highlighting this bruise.
Alright, down here in the corner, this little silver outlet here with a screw cap on it. That was an outlet for his central vacuuming system that he had installed here in the home. All the maids had to do to clean up the place was connect up a log hose to that outlet. They could then suck up all the dirt and dust around here. It'd all be taken down the tanks and the machine rooms down below. When they were done, they'd disconnect, cap it up, and move on to the next outlet, where they'd then continue that process. Unfortunately, he did use a cloth hose on the other side of those outlets, and that has deteriorated over time. And so today, all we have are little silver outlets up here and there throughout the home. Fireplace up here is the largest fireplace that we have here in the castle. Of the 24 fireplaces that are here, part or all of 20 of those fireplaces was imported from somewhere over in Europe. This one, however, was not one of those. It's one of those four domestic ones. This one is made of Indiana limestone, which is the same material that's around all the arched windows and doorways here in the castle also. One thing that makes this fireplace unique is not only is it the largest fireplace, but it's also what we call a freestanding fireplace, meaning there's basically no mortar or cement between any of these blocks of stone. Just the sheer weight of those stones, plus what I like to call the jigsaw puzzle effect, pulls this fireplace together. Know anything about that construction technique, you would know that there would be at least one keystone to this fireplace. In fact, there are two. The main keystone is the top stone of the upper arch here, right up there. Secondary is the top stone of this lower arch. If you were to pull one or both of those stones out, the whole thing is going to come tumbling down. Don't ask me to demonstrate at all. Okay, the three chandeliers hanging overhead here in the middle of the room are the original brass electric chandeliers that Palmer had put into this place. And I did say electric because he had electricity here at his grounds in the year 1882. It's the same year that New York City first turned on their lights. He had a coal-fired steam-powered generator here in the grounds to generate the electricity that he used here. Also, not wanting to be a waster of energy, he realized that the exhaust product of that electrical making process was hot water. And so he had that hot water pumped through radiators and located in the buildings around here. Thus, the radiator heat was the primary source of the heat rather than the fireplace, like you might think with the building having 24 of them in there. But he also realized that freestanding radiators in a room this size would heat it very inefficiently. And so he had those radiators down and put in what we call the catacombs. He had large ductworks with fans that would blow air past those radiators. And then the hot air would then come out the black vents you can see on various parts of the walls around here. Thus, he had forced air heating here in his home shortly after the turn of the century. And that was basically unheard of back then, especially out in this area. So he was a little advanced for his time. Any questions about this room before we move on down the hall?
What we call the Dutch door variety means you can't open the top half of the door while leaving the bottom half closed. The reason for that, you could then enjoy the nice fresh air here of Colorado, but still keep the little animals outside where they belong. You know, I don't know if there was much of a problem here on the second floor, down on the first floor, the chipmunks and the squirrels around here, they can be rather friendly at times, especially if you have any food out, you know. And so this way you can still enjoy the fresh air, but keep them outside where they belong. Down here a little bit farther. Now this hanging here on the wall, if I were to ask you as to whether you thought this was a picture that someone took with a camera or a drawing that someone drew by hand, some of you would think it's one, some of you would think it's the other, but you would all be correct. Because this is called a picture portrait. The reason for that, back when this was made, dated 1890 in the lower left corner over there, cameras weren't that good. They couldn't focus the objects both close up and far away. So they would take a picture with the close-up things, like the hills, the trees here, being an actual photograph, develop it, mount it up like this, and then someone would come in and draw in the background scene and create the portrait side. And so that's why it's called a picture portrait. This is one of those original pieces of furniture that Palmer had, and it may have very well hung right here in this hallway. This hallway is called Oriel Hall, or it was his picture and art gallery. He had numerous other pictures and paintings hanging on the walls around here. And if you want to look up at the ceiling, you'll see your bank. Type of design you don't see in many homes today. That's because that is made of plaster. How that is made is they've spread a thin layer of plaster along the ceiling, and then they have molds in that shape. Fill them up, prop them up against the ceiling, fasten them there, and then let them dry. When they're all dry, they then peel those molds off. And Palma was rather particular about the work that he had done here. So they were supposed to inspect the ceiling, and if they found any flaws anywhere on the ceiling, they were supposed to scrape it all off and start all over again. So who knows how many times they may have had to do that, but as you look around the ceiling today, you can't can find a few cracks here and there, but believe me, we do not intend to scrape it all off to start all over again. Put on a little farther. Upper one, if you can see that one. Those tiles that you're looking at are about 480 years old. Those are tiles that Palmer bought off a 400-year-old London cathedral that was being torn down. He had each of those in the rest of it, but we left these here so we could show you about 480-year-old tiles. No, that's fine. Palmer owned a lot of things around the town here, and one of the things he owned at site, the first one that he owned, burned to the ground in a roaring fire in the year 1898. And being that he started construction here in his new home about 6 years later, he still remembered that fire very vividly in his mind. He didn't want the same thing happening here, so he did a few things to try to prevent a major fire like that from happening. One of the things he did was to install the steel fire door. In the event of a fire in either half of the castle, this door could be pulled out all the way to the floor, and the fire, if not stopped, would at least be slowed from passing from one half of the building to the other. And we are very glad he put it in because we can still use it today. Fortunately, though, we have a fire. Get up here a little bit farther. The small arch doorway here off to your left, that's the entrance to the servant's wing. Are any of you staying down there? Don't worry, we won't push you to work cleaning up after you. This is where Palmer housed the female servants that he had working for him here in the castle. The male servants were housed in the upstairs of the carriage house down below. And that kind of went along with his Quaker upbringing. He didn't feel the men and the single men and women servants should be together. But there are lots of stories that say they didn't have the same beliefs. But we avoid those. So anyway, this doorway right here that I'm standing in has some significance in that when you travel through this doorway, you can say it's kind of like traveling back through time, from 1905 back to 1871. Because when Palmer built the castle here, he didn't destroy his original house that he built in 1871. He remodeled the exterior of it and then added on. Well, this was the original outside wall for that first house. And when you come through the doorway here, you'll notice three main differences after coming through. One, the hallway does get narrower. Two, the ceiling is higher. And three, wood paneling on the walls on this side of the doorway, something a little different over here on the other side. As we're walking through here, I want you to take a look, a feel, try to figure out what you think Palmer put on the walls to create that texture there. I'm going to ask your opinions on the other end here in just a minute. Let's see. Being you're going to get stretched out over this narrow hallway, I'll explain the stairway to you. That small narrow staircase that will be coming up on your right-hand side looks more like it's built for mountain goats than for people, but that was the servant's stairway. That's the stairway they used to get around the building here, and you've already probably used the main stairway, to which family stairway we'll use that in just a minute here. So come on through here. Top 15 inches of white design up there. Would any of you want to venture a guess as to what you think that is made of? Very good guess, but not correct.
Not correct.
Macaroni.
Not macaroni. Paper mache. Exactly. Have you ever been on a tour before?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. You do not become number 9 then.
I didn't remember that.
It is paper mache. Palmer had long strips of that brought over here from Europe. And he had handcrafters molded into that design up there. That is the original paper mache. It has been preserved over the years with a few coats of paint up there on top of it, however. Now this cabinet over here, I opened up the bottom half of the door, so if you look inside, you can see a fire hose. Palmer put fire hoses here and there throughout the home, just in case there was a fire. Whip it out, turn on the valve. Good way to help put out any fire that might have started here in the home. We can still use those today, but we've had to replace that cloth hose because here again, that deteriorates over time. But Palmer spent a lot of money on his plumbing system. He used nickel-plated brass, that silver pipe you see coming out of the top there. Supposedly that's never to corrode, and it has done very well over the years because basically it is the same plumbing system that we use here in the castle today. So a pretty good system that he had in here. Closet over here with our semi-fake stained glass window in it today is nothing more than a housekeeping closet. Back when Palmer lived here, that was an elevator. In the year 1906, Palmer was involved in a horse riding accident where he was thrown off of the horse, landed on his neck, broke it in three places. I'll forget my fingers. From that point on, his life was paralyzed from the neck down. And so he was confined to a wheelchair, so he had an elevator installed that went from the third to the second on down to the first floor. This way he could just move about his home a little bit easier. That was removed, however, by the third owner of the property. We're not exactly sure why. Unfortunately, however, we didn't end up with it here today. From here, we take the tour downstairs. The reason the third floor, if you're up there, is basically a mirror image of this floor here, same layout, basically, and stock wall, wood designs, and so forth. The difference between the floors, however, was that this floor was the family floor. This is the floor that they lived on. Palmer and Queen were in room 201 here, with 202 is their adjoining sitting room, and then the daughters were in the rooms on down the hall here. And then the third floor was used for any relatives or any guests who might be staying out here. And so that was the main differences between those two floors. One interesting little note, sometimes I throw this in a tour, sometimes I don't, I'll go ahead and throw it in. But after Palmer's riding accident, being that he was confined to a wheelchair, as is common with lots of wheelchair patients, they developed bed sores. And to alleviate this problem, Palmer had two India rubber pieces sewn together to form a pillow, and then it was filled with water, kind of a little rubber seat pillow. And it worked very well for him in the chair, and so they have made an adaptation of that same design for a bed. They sewed a whole bunch of these pillows together filled with water, and then Palmer may have been one of the first to have a water bed here in his home. That bed, however, was very comfortable, I guess, and the third owner of the property wanted that when he moved out of the building over to one of the other buildings. He wanted that bed over there with him. And upon trying to get it out of the building, they couldn't bring it out through the doorway here, so they had to lower it out by cables through one of the windows. But while they were lowering it, one of the cables and the supports or something broke, and the bed went crashing down below, and kind of had a whole bunch of wet toothpicks laying around on the ground. So that ended his little water bed anyway. So he may have been one of the first with the water bed here in his home. Come on down here. Okay, this room out here was just the entryway or the foyer to the entire castle. Once again, you notice we are back to the wood paneling on the walls, also the plaster work up there on the ceiling, same type of design. And over here we have two booths. One of them there has a telephone label on it, and you know, I seriously doubt it had a telephone label on it back when Palmer lived here. However, it did have a telephone there. Palmer was one of the first west of Kansas City to have a telephone here in his home, but I always like to want to bring up this fact. Think about this. If you're first with a telephone in your area, who are you going to call? Well, he has solved that problem because he had several extensions here on the grounds that he could either call to or from. And he also had an extension set up at Colorado College, a college in town that he founded. And he actually used the connection between here and the college most every day. The other booth over there with the frosted window on top was the lower exit to the elevator that he had here in the room. Also, today we use it for storage.
Happy birthday, Patty.
Fireplace up behind me here is another one of the 20. This one dates back to about the 15th or 16th century, is of Welsh descent, and is made of hand-carved English oak and hammered armor plate down here below. And the railing around the front here, you can't see from the table, there is a railing here, had the purpose in that if any of the guests or family were out riding in their horses or carriages, they might come back a little chilled. Well, the servants would always have a fire going here in the fireplace, so upon their return, they could come in here and kneel on the lower part of the railing or sit on the upper part around here and warm up by the fireplace, thus not having to pull the chair from some other part of the room or some other room entirely. So it was just a little convenience item to help them warm up by. Carlos over here is not one of Palmer's. This is, however, a real night suit sent over to us piece by piece from one of our staff over in Europe. Don't know a whole lot of history about him other than he is built for a small statured man of about 5'6", slender build. We call him Carlos because on the sword that he used to have out here in front, on the side of it, it said Carlos. And so that's where he got his name. So come on in here to Palmer's dining room. He had a large round table sitting here that normally had about 18 Tupendale style chairs sitting around it. And it's in this room that's a good place to describe his philosophy concerning his servants. Because you see, Palmer liked his servants' work to be seen, but not necessarily the servant. And how I accomplished that here in this room was through that doorway today is our conference office. You probably know, but back then, that was the kitchen. He didn't want to have the servants going back and forth through that door all the time because that could be rather disruptive to any conversation out here at the table. So he had a pass-through window installed. And if you take your eyes and look at that light over there on the wall, blue guys, 1.5 panels to the left, 2 panels down, right between the tree and the bench there, there's a little brass ring. Let's see that right there, yeah. Okay. That was a latch. Those 2 panels would open up, creating the pass-through window between the kitchen and the dining room. Thus, anything that was needed was passed through to one servant who was stationed out here, and they would be solely responsible for taking care of everyone, thus eliminating the back and forth through the door all the time. Now, underneath the sculpture of the bald eagle over there is a square piece of furniture called a humidor. It's kind of a cedar chest type thing, and Palmer used it to keep animal skins in. If you haven't guessed, that is the second of the original pieces of furniture. And he kept the animal skins in there because when the ladies would go out riding in the carriages, generally they were in dresses. They could take one of those skins and then drape it over the legs to help keep them warm while they're out riding. Upon the return, stick the skin back in there for safekeeping. Originally, however, that was out here in the entryway area. On around over here, originally there were glass doors all across this inside end here, creating a wall, and formed another room called the solarium over there. Basically, it had 2 purposes, because during the summertime, open up the glass doors on the inside and the outside, have a little extended dining room. You could feed a few more faces around here. Or during the wintertime, close up the doors on the inside and the outside, bring in some plants, have a little indoor greenhouse to help some of those plants winter over just a little bit better. We had to remove the three center panels of the door because when we put the carpet down, we couldn't open the doors anymore, so they're not being there. Fireplace up here in front, another one of the 20. We believe it dates back to about 1650. It electrically rang the 2,000 pound silver alloy bell he had made over in Essen, Germany, brought over here and located up on top of the octagonal tower. And reportedly the sound of that bell can be heard up to 3 miles away. We can still ring that bell today. It's still up there. However, we do it the old-fashioned way. We pull a rope. But anyway. Now, do any of you think our castle should have some sort of secret hiding place or anything like that? Any of you? Moderate interest here. Well, I'll show you anyway. Yes, we do have something we could call a secret hiding place. However, Palmer did intend for it to be real practical because inside here is nothing more than a fire hose. Here again, putting him throughout the home, he just didn't want this one to be real conspicuous. So it was tucked away in the side of the fireplace here for easy access, especially by putting out the fire here. Also, you may have noticed these little white buttons located on the walls here and there throughout the home. They are a part of his servant call system, or annunciator system as he called it. And how it worked was if any of the guests or family needed assistance from the servants, you could push one of these buttons. Inside the kitchen, there was a panel. A little flag would drop down indicating which of the buttons around the grounds had been pushed. The servant could then push the corresponding button below that panel, and a little buzz would be heard behind here, indicating to the person needing the assistance that their call was being answered. And I love telling people who are staying here in the castle today that you can push those buttons all you want, but nobody's going to come and help you. They have been disconnected from the electricity, and today we use some of the wiring for other things here in the home. Let's come on into Palmer's library. Okay, this room in here was Palmer's library, and he kept a lot of his books here in this room. But basically, there are 2 things to point out about this room. One, this is the first floor to the octagonal tower. There are basically 8 sides to this room. And 2, the fireplace up behind me here is one of the oldest known artifacts to us here in the castle. And reportedly, this fireplace was carved between the 1200s and the 1400s by Benedictine monks over in Europe. And there's a little story that goes along with the three carved figures up there on top. And that over here on the left, we have Adam holding the apple, indicating his part in man's first sin. Over here on the right is Eve holding the serpent, indicating her part in the first sin. In the middle here, we have the angel of the garden holding the cross of Christ, signifying that through Christ's death and resurrection, he is our only hope of returning to the garden to be with God. And
oh, you got your own kids?
Well, I do think it would be a good time to catch them instead of doing the morning. And I knew if I wanted to catch the other one, I'd come. I called back. If I wanted to catch the others, I'd have to kill them about 7 minutes. So you can get the dishwasher.
Oh, that's bad.
She did it on
the
floor. Because the flash. Somehow, the rest of it looked like it was a stick of ice on the little side. And the flash stayed down there.
We're outside, waiting to go to Cripple Creek.
I just started doing that with her. And for extra work around the house, I
thought that
comment that I can't remember.
But anyway, I said there's rules. Yeah, in the
April. Rules under the new law.
Yeah,
there are rules under the new
law. You still have rules. What was
it? Since like.
Yeah. Yeah, because she said, the teacher said, you have to play the game this way to get this. I mean, she just didn't say hard.
Although, that in school we have lessons, we have assignments, but it's up to you whether you participate, whether you do it. So it really was.
All right.
Oh, no.
All right. All right. Need some people to sit on here, and then the wives sit in front of them, and the same thing kind of right back there. Well, you probably can stand back.
Can we move the $2 chair?
Yeah. Get those things out here. I mean,
we got the press corps up there.
Sunshine in my eyes.